Hello students and welcome to my channel. Today we are going to understand the last part of the chapter Deep Water, written by Mr. William O. Douglas. Before getting started, I would like to quote some lines from a very beautiful poem, the poem that talks about courage. So let's see these lines first of all. Courage isn't a dazzling light that flashes and passes away from sight. It's a slow, unwavering, ingrained trait, with the patience to work and the strength to wait. It's part of a man when his skies are blue. It's part of him when he has work to do. The brave man never is freed of it. He has it when there is no need of it. So yes, courage is something that doesn't just go away. It's not a flash of light that appears for a moment or two. It is there, inside someone, whether we are afraid or whether we are not. No matter how big our opponent is, no matter how big the fear is, courage is something that shines within. And courage doesn't come all by itself. It is achieved, attained with the help of hard work, determination, the spirit of never giving up. Something that was clearly shown by Mr. William Douglas. When for many years he could not enjoy boating, canoeing, fishing, swimming at all, and he realized that something was lacking in his life, that is when he decided to learn how to swim all over again, and he decided to get out of his phobia too. When he tried all by himself and could not succeed, he decided to take professional help. He hired an instructor, and with the help of the instructor for around 6 months, he learned rigorously. After 6 months, the instructor was done. And that is when he said, "You must start swimming in the swimming pool without any fear." So we will get started from this point only. I did. The instructor was finished, but I was not finished. I still wondered if I would be terror-stricken when I was alone in the pool. I tried it. I swam the length up and down. Tiny vestiges of the old terror would return. But now I could frown and say to that terror, "Trying to scare me, huh? Well, here's to you. Look." And off I would go for another length of the pool. So when Mr. Douglas decided to swim in the swimming pool, there were some small remains of the fear, but he was very confident and he brushed aside the fear and was not at all afraid of it. But you know what? He wanted to learn swimming, not to swim in the swimming pool. He wanted to learn how to swim so that he could go to the natural water bodies, swim in them. Go to fishing, go for canoeing, river rafting and whatnot. He wanted to enjoy the water sports. So he should have the courage to encounter a natural water body. That is what he did to ensure whether the fear has completely gone or not. The last two lines. This went on until July. But I was still not satisfied. I was not sure that all the terror had left. So I went to Lake Wentworth in New Hampshire, dived off a dock at Triggs Island and swam 2 miles across the lake to Stampact Island. Students, there is a question in the book that how did William or Mr. Douglas confirm that fear has completely left? So this is the answer to that question, that he went to Lake Wentworth and some other water bodies also. But more importantly, Lake Wentworth is to be mentioned. The question usually appears in the board examination. It's a short answer type question and this is the answer to it. I swam the crawl breaststroke, side stroke and backstroke. Only once did the terror return. When I was in the middle of the lake, I put my face under and saw nothing but bottomless water. The old sensation returned in miniature. I laughed and said, "Well, Mr. Terror, what do you think you can do to me?" It fled and I swam on. So no matter how big the terror was, it fled. It just ran away. Why? Because William Douglas was confident enough. William Douglas was courageous enough. Yet I had residual doubts. So even after going to Lake Wentworth, which is actually, lakes are quite quiet actually, very silent. Still he was quite confused. That is why he decided to go to some other places. At my first opportunity, I hurried west, went up to the Titan to Conrad Meadows, up the Conrad Creek Trail to Mead Glacier, and camped in the high meadow by the side of Warm Lake. Now this entire part is filled with proper nouns, the names of places. I would like to show you some pictures so that you can understand a bit. This is a dock. So on the other side, in front of you, there is the lake, and then we have the dock to jump off in the lake. And on this side, from where the picture is taken, there might be an island. So if you want to jump in the lake, what you would do, you will go to an island or the landmass, reach to the dock and jump off into the lake. This is a meadow. It's very, very common in English literature. Meadow is nothing but a small piece of grassland, especially where hay is produced. So as you can see here, the color is brown, not green. It's not the green grassland, but a grassland to produce hay especially. And this is a creek trail through which he went to that particular place. So it's usually found in the forest. It's not the proper road. People go for hiking with the help of the creek trail. The same was done by Mr. William Douglas. Now we will read it, this entire part, all over again. I hurried west, went up to the Titan to Conrad Meadows, up the Conrad Creek Trail. So he went to the meadows. Via the meadows, he went to the creek trail to Mead Glacier and camped in the high meadow by the side of the Warm Lake. So from that place, he went to Warm Lake, and beside that he camped. The next morning I stripped, dived into the lake and swam across to the other shore and back, just as Duck Corporon used to do. I shouted with joy, and Gilbert Peak returned the echo. I had conquered my fear of water. Duck Corporon is mentioned here. He was a master swimmer and he was a physician basically, and he, along with his wife, worked a lot for the people of Yakima, that entire area. And that is why he is known today. But he used to swim wonderfully, you know, very fastly from one end to another and without any fear at all. So when William Douglas was in the Warm Lake and he swam perfectly, he was very happy. And he was so confident that he shouted with joy, and he felt that he could not achieve something as big as Duck Corporon, but he did something that Duck Corporon used to do, that swimming in the lake to and fro, to and fro. So he was definitely very happy to be compared to somebody so big. And this is the picture of Gilbert Peak beside the Warm Lake. Here somewhere he camped, and he was inside the lake and he swam perfectly. And when he shouted with joy, Gilbert Peak returned the echo. The experience had a deep meaning for me, as only those who have known stark terror and conquered it can appreciate. In death, there is peace. There is terror only in the fear of death. As Roosevelt knew when he said, "All we have to fear is fear itself." Because I had experienced both the sensation of dying and the terror that fear of it can produce, the will to live somehow grew in intensity. I would like to repeat it because I committed some mistakes over here. So I had experienced both the sensation of dying and the terror that fear of it can produce. The will to live somehow grew in intensity. So that's how it goes. Mr. Roosevelt, Franklin D. Roosevelt, with whom William Douglas worked, he was a friend and an advisor to this famous man, the icon. And Franklin D. Roosevelt, the 32nd President of the United States of America. Here he is His quote is written, "Men are not prisoners of fate, but only prisoners of their own minds." Once you are out of that captured fear and do what you wish to do, you are free of everything. So William Douglas experienced death. You remember when he was inside the pool, drowning, he felt released. He felt comfortable. That light was there. The silence was there. There was no panic, no terror, no struggle at all. It appeared that he was going to sleep and it was all so soothing. Death itself is peaceful. But while you are struggling to save yourself from death, that is where panic is. That is where terror is. Death is peaceful. It is the fear of death that is more frightening. And because he has experienced both, that is why he can say that we have to get out of the fear. Death is inevitable. It will happen to everyone. But that fear of death takes away the beauty of life. At last, I felt released, free to walk the trails and climb the peaks and to brush aside fear. There are 2 to 3 words here. Released here means free. Trails are paths, peaks, the mountain peaks. So at last, after conquering over his fear for so long, fear that captured him for so long, he felt free, finally. And now he could go anywhere, any path he could attain. He could go to as high places as he wanted. He could go to any water body, go for swimming and canoeing and fishing and whatnot. He could enjoy life. That made him overwhelmed with joy, pride, and whatnot. It was the result of his courage, his determination, his devotion towards never giving up, fighting back with that fear, which was humongous for sure. So once you are out of the clutches of fear, your personality becomes free and you can explore it as much as you want. Students, fear is something that limits you. Fear is something that stops you from exploring the world and exploring yourself also. That is why Mr. Roosevelt said that all we have to fear is fear itself. Keep that fear aside, far away from you, and live life to the fullest, each and every moment, right now, right here. And this is one of the quotes written by another Mr. Roosevelt, another president of the United States of America. Courage isn't the absence of fear. It's the choice that something else is greater than that fear. And that was achieved by Mr. William Douglas. When fear was gone, everything was in front of him. Life was in front of him and he could enjoy that life. It's an autobiographical account, a first-hand account, and that is why the depiction is so vivid. The depiction inside the swimming pool, the depiction of the struggle, the dedicated hard work of Mr. William Douglas, with the help of which he could get over the fear. And through this autobiographical pattern, we can understand that how big the fear was, because we saw that how William Douglas was struggling inside the water and how he suffered due to hydrophobia. No matter how big the fear is, still he overcame it. So no matter how big the fear is, everyone can overcome it. He sets an example. That is why he went back to his memories. He went to a recapitulation of all those struggling moments and wrote them down to make the people aware that fear is something we cannot live with. It has to be eradicated somehow. And this is the last thing. One day you will thank yourself for never giving up. The chapter is in this book to make you aware of this. You are in a very delicate age. Do not be in the clutches of fear. Don't stop yourself. because of the fear. Get out of the fear. Get to know the world. Get to know yourself. Try new things. Build new things. Build your own character, a good one at that. Don't give up. Later in your lives, you will be very happy that yes, I did the good thing. I did not give up. And that is why I am here doing something wonderful today, something that I want. So if you want to live your life, you have to get out of the fear, no matter how big, no matter how small. And later, one day, you will be happy with yourself. And that's what life is. You have to be happy with yourself. With this, let's close it now. I think Deep Water, this chapter, leaves a huge impact on the personality of the reader. Go through the text again and then enjoy each and every moment of it. Understand the fear experienced by Douglas and understand his dedication also to overcome it. Thank you.